Oke. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the 2021 International Conference Environmental Law, Applied Science and Technology, or ICOFLAS, is an international conference organized by Jana Bhadra University. The honorable all lecturers and all participants of this seminar, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Muhammad Ramadan, the moderator of today. I am replace your moderator as Miss Yafida. I'm very pleased to see you here and welcome of the ICOFLAS. Today's conference is about environmental science, environmental law and policy mitigation and technique and geospatial technology. Ladies and gentlemen, before the presentation begins, let me inform how the presentation will be going on. First, the participant will be invited to present the material. After that, there will be question and answer session. Now, allow me to welcome the first speakers. The title, Environmental Friendly Cycling Habit Behavior Called Social Influence. Hedonic motivation and psychological need develop it. Please, Mr. Andreas, time is yours.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Always good to be here to
Well, thank you for the opportunity. I hope everyone can hear me very clearly at the moment. Thank you for the all right. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's always good to be here to present our paper for today. The title is Environmentally Friendly Cycling Habit Behavior. Could social influence, hedonic motivation, and psychological needs develop it? If you notice on the title, there's a question mark at the end, because this is our the main of our research is to get the point. Could social influence, hedonic motivation, and psychological needs develop the environmental friendly cycling habit behavior? As a new habit, the cycling behavior was developed during the pandemic, the 2020 actually. If we are looking at the trend of bicycle selling, the main event or the peak sales occurs on 2020, which is the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic. This is the 5-year trend, starting at 2017 and ending at 2021. The peak season, the peak selling season is on 2020. That's when the new habit developed. The motivation, there are some motivation for the new habit. The main motivation is to improve the quality of individual health, which is divided by three main categories. The first one is increasing immune system. That's the main reason for this new habit, because during the new habit, the doctors, the medical person, they are shouting for the immune system. And one of the critical point to increase the immune system is doing the healthy lifestyle, which is cycling is included in it. The second one is the need to achieve physical fitness, which is part of the increasing immune system. And the healthy lifestyle itself is the only main reason for this. The new cycling habit, is this really preserving environment or just a lifestyle that is becoming a trend? This is the main question. Actually, if we look, we are looking at the trending sales of the bicycle, we can see that during the end of 2020, the sales is already declining. So this question began to rise, preserving environment or just a lifestyle that is becoming a trend. Environmentally friendly behavior or EFB is created by three drivers. The first one is hedonic motivation. The second one is social influence. And the third one is psychological need. Besides the theory plan of behavior, sorry, the theory of planned behavior, looking at the external and internal motivational factor. Thus, we have to use the self-determination theory model to relate this to the environmentally friendly behavior. So there are three main reason for this, which is the environmentally friendly behavior, the theory of planned behavior, and self-determinative theory model, which we use to relate to environmentally friendly behavior. Hedonic motivation and environmentally behavior has been developed by previous researchers. That's why we use hedonic motivation has a positive effect on EFB as our first hypothesis. The second hypothesis, we try to relate this, still determining for the previous research. Social influence has a positive effect on EFB. That's our second hypothesis. And the third one, psychological needs and environmentally friendly behavior. We use that at the third hypothesis, which is psychological needs has a positive effect on EFB. This is our research model. The hedonic motivation, X1, social influence, X2, psychological needs, X3, which are related to environmentally friendly behavior. Are they really related? The research subject that we are using for this research is bicycle users in Yogyakarta as the population. Random sampling method was used to gain the sample for this research. Who are bicycle users whom active using their bicycle for transport and hobby purposes? So there are two categories here, transport and hobby purposes. And the period of research is November 22nd until December 5th, 2020. The findings of this research, hedonic motivation and psychological needs are significant, but not the social influence, which is very interesting here. The strongest predictor for this research is the psychological needs of the EFB cycling habits. And the hedonic motivation and the psychological needs have a positive effect on the EFB. Therefore, our first and third hypothesis is supported in this research, but not the second one, not the social influence. Here we can see the social influence cannot be a single driver affecting the EFB. Other than that, growth tendencies and innate psychological needs also tend to drive the self-motivation and personality integration. Therefore, this will foster those the positive processes on this cycling habit. That's the thing that we can present in this afternoon for this research, and I'll put the time back to the moderator. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the speaker for giving us such informative and interesting presentation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the question and answer session. I'd like to have three questions from the participant, please. Any question? No question?
No question. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Andreas, for your presentation. Now, allow me to welcome the second speaker with the title Public Trust Doctrine in Indonesia, Expectation and Prospect. Please welcome Ms. Murti Ayu Hapsari. Time is yours.
Okay, thank you very much for the chance. Today I'm going to present my paper. Okay. So our paper is Public Trust Doctrine in Indonesia, Expectation and Prospect. I am Murti Ayu Hapsari, acting as the presenter for today. So what is exactly a public trust doctrine? So we have to look at this. I break it down in three different things. The first one is the raise of awareness in sustainable development. The second one is the originality of PTD or public trust doctrine. And the third one is there is a similar concept of that doctrine in our concept in Indonesia's 1945 constitution, especially in Article 33. So about the raise of awareness in sustainable development is actually back in 1960s in the US, there's a raise of awareness of public on public domain, that is actually they aware that human welfare is heavily related to the environmental to their environment. So what is public trust doctrine? So public trust doctrine is public is the object of beneficiary of a trust that is held by the state. Therefore, the state hold the responsibility to manage that trust on behalf of the public beneficiaries. This concept trust hold excellent potential for environment protection. The concept of public interest or common goal is a concept that benefits society as a whole, as contrast to the private goods of individual. So in this case, public trust doctrine is said something like that environment, natural resources is supposedly managed or supposedly controlled by the state so that the profit that gained from it is used for the great or for the benefit for society as a whole, something like that. So as I said before, there is a similarity of that concept in our constitution, that is in Article 32.2 and Article 33.3, that basically said that the land, the waters, and natural resources shall be within under the power of the state and shall be used for the greatest benefit of the people. And the Article 33.2 said that the sector of production which are important for the country and affect the life of the people shall be under the power of the state. So it's basically the same concept. So it is just said that natural resources and sector that is important and vital for the benefit of people shall be managed and shall be under the power of or under the control of the state for the greatest benefit of the people, as the contrast of private ownership or individual ownership, something like that. So the problem here is, even though we already have that concept in our constitution, that article does not translate well in specific regulation. Yeah, the reason is being example of law number 11 of 2020 on job creation. Some of you might familiar with omnibus law, and law number 3 of 2020 on mineral and coal mining, among many others. The so-called development on those laws is only focused on the improving economic growth with little concern regarding human development or environmental sustainability. So actually, in those laws, the so-called development is only on some material level. The development in that laws only focus on economic growth, only focus on something that we can see, something that material like infrastructure, or making deforestation on something like that. So it's actually without some studies that actually comprehensive, without without little concern regarding human development, especially environment sustainability. So in order to understand or more deeply about these cases, I took three examples about the origin and practices in three countries. The first one is US, and then India, and South Africa. So in United States, this doctrine, public trust doctrine, is already constructed and incorporated in the state constitution. So we can see that the states already have a big, a long-term commitment regarding this problem. And in that specific provision, it stated there is six kinds of natural resources that are subject to this public trust. There is inland navigable waterways, public access, water rights, water quality, fish and wildlife resources, and then the last is air resources. And the next one, in India, India is also have a fundamental value. So in India, there is this environmental right, fundamental right. So environmental ecological right is classified as a fundamental value in their constitution. It is already stated in their constitution that the right to life is to embrace the protection and preservation of natural resources. This doctrine is already well established in domestic law and in their legal system. So specifically in their constitution and then in their laws, it's already stated that the government has a duty as a trustee to protect and improve the quality of environment as well as the safeguard. And then the last one is in South Africa. As we all know that this country has a very long gray history about oppression and racial discrimination, so that their Bill of Rights is one of the most progressive Bill of Rights in the world. In that Bill of Rights, explicitly states that environmental rights are one of the fundamental rights. So the legislator of that country already introduced PTD or public trust doctrine as part of their national law, because they're already incorporated that in their constitution. It has already expanded dramatically the environment, public human rights of the public at the expense of individual rights of private property owners. So from what I say in the beginning, that the chapter or 14 of Indonesia 1945 Constitution, it's already assert or already stated that state responsibility is to promote and to develop a guaranteed social justice and economic society and economic sovereignty for the people. And they specifically said that Article 33.3 required state to control land, water, and natural resources. So basically, PTD is already become a fundamental basis of Indonesian environmental legislation. But the problem is that it does not translate well, as I stated before. So It because the perspective of environment protection has yet been mainstream in the regulation. So the paradigm is not there yet. In the regulation level, there is not there yet because the benefit distribution is not equally distributed. And there is inadequate safeguard against traditional use as well. And then there is a lack of mechanism that is strictly enforced in environmental law settings. So in this case, in this paper, we are trying to propose that PTD can be used as a stepping stone, as a benchmark from Indonesian citizens to fight for their environmental and economic rights in the courts. Importantly, if this doctrine were to be adopted and integrated in Indonesia, the first step would be an amendment to the current applied environmental law in Indonesia. So it is something that possibly can be done, not something that's completely impossible. So the conclusion is that the basis is already there. The basic of PTD is already there in our constitution. But in the practice and enforcement, it shows the opposite side. It shows that the exploration of natural resources strengthen the wall of wealth inequality, which gap between citizen and private owned companies. So in order to be incorporated, the PTD can be incorporated into Indonesian environmental law, is first by the amending the existing environmental law. Thank you for the time. I'm giving my time back to Mr. Ramadan. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Murti. Your presentation is very awesome. I like your paper. That's your paper, many information on your paper. That's now. Allow me to call now come to question and answer session. I like to have three questions from the participant. Any question? I hope one question for this paper. No question? Mr. Andreas, any question?
Not at this moment.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Eri, you have question for Ms. Murti? Not yet. Okay, thank you so much for my participant conference today. Now, allow me to welcome the third speaker. With the title Tourism Mitigation Among Crises, a Case Study from Borobudur in Environmental, Economic and Social Perspective. From Mr. Nindyo Cahyo Kresnanto, please welcome. Time is yours. Yes, please. Okay, yes, please, Mr. Nindyo. Thank you, Mr.
My is it still not clear? Okay, Ma. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for this opportunity to present our research paper. A study from Borobudur in environment, economic, and social perspective. Research paper conducted by Nindya Chandra Fernando, IM, from Master of Civil Engineering, Engineering Faculty, Jana Bhattacharya University, and the second author is Riza Putri from Accounting Department, Jana Bhattacharya University. Okay, and this I will divide into three parts of discussion. Firstly, I will discuss about the background of our research. In this background, I will explain you about the why the research is important to conduct. And the secondly, I will discuss about the data and the methods approach where I use in this research. And lastly, I will inform you about the conclusion and some suggestion for next research. Okay. Let's begin for the background of research. The main question in this research to ask why the research is important is why we research about the tourism. Yeah, why we research about the tourism. The first thing I think the important is the tourism sector is the one sector that contribute to GDP, yeah, to GDP. In Indonesia, tourism sector contributes more than 4.70% of Indonesian GDP. Okay, that's the important thing. And the second thing why the research is important is the tourism sector is very vulnerable, yeah, and to many various conditions. Yeah, and many conditions like economic condition, security, political policy, natural disaster, and pandemic. In the next session, in the next slide, I will show you why I state that the tourism is sector that's very vulnerable. Okay. Okay. If any question about why we choose Borobudur as the subject of our research, we can look at these figures in the left of the presentation. We can look the Borobudur visitor number of visitor in Borobudur reached 3.5 million per year. 3.5 million per year number of visitor. This is the highest number of visitor and tourism destination in Jawa Tengah and the area. Yeah, why we choose the Borobudur as a subject as our research? Okay, then the reason, the second reason, the tourism. Number of tourism affect by the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic. You can look at this graph. Yeah, for this graph is the trend of number of visitor in Borobudur from 1995 to 2022. Yeah, 2022. You can look at this graph from 1995 to 2092, there is growth of number of tourism, and then in 2019, when we facing the pandemic COVID-19, the number of visitor dropped down very deeply. Yeah, for I think 300,000 to 100,000. Okay. Drop down deeply. Now, this is the reason why the importance of our research. Okay. And the next discussion, I will discuss about this is the objective of our research. What model could predict the number of Borobudur tourism visitor growth after the pandemic state finishes by government? Yeah, okay. This is our objective research. And the data we use to conduct this research, we have data from
management of Borobudur. The data is about the tourism visitor based on parking numbers under the parking. Why access is the tourism visitor by number of car, access is the years.
Time from 2020. We can look at this graph.
The trend of number of visitors in Borobudur very vulnerable.
Like that in
1997 there is a crisis. Number of visitors was from
137,000 to 107,000, decreased more than 21. Yeah, there is any monetary crisis, and then in 2002, any political crisis, the number of visitor in Borobudur decreased more than 18%, and so on. And
most decreased on number of visitor in Borobudur when there is
COVID pandemic.
In Indonesia, from
300,000
to 100,000.
Yeah.
Decrease more than 60%.
60%. Yeah.
From
100,000 to
100,000. Yeah. Decrease the number of visitor of Borobudur.
Has decreased more than 60%.
So this data. That we use input data, and we use a regression analysis method to predict
the growth after the COVID pandemic, and
we use empirical data to approach
empirical data of on tourism recovery process.
This is the empirical data that we use to approach our model. Yeah, we can look at the line is number of visitor.
Pandemic.
After begin the start pandemic, the number of visitors go down, and then after 14 months, they grow up again until the same level before pandemic. You can imagine that.
That? Okay.
Need 14 months to go back to start level. Okay. At the pandemic effect to tourism. And then we can look at the another crisis, like Europe during global crisis.
Need
29 months to recover our visitor, to back again to survival. Yeah, to recovery.
29 months.
But you can look at the crisis, America after 2011.
Bom Bali.
Wind tower crisis.
Yeah. To go back again.
Yeah. To back to normal again. To recover itu.
Need 42 months.
Okay.
We use the American data to approach our model. We have the time of recovery to approach a normal model.
Okay. That's the result of the model.
Before pandemic and the predicted. This is the empirical data and the and right presentation. This is the model.
We
use starting point the same as the last number of visitors, the highest last number of visitors, yeah, and 2017, okay, and so the start model to predict
as the A point. This is the first model.
And the second model.
We assume the starting model in a NB point.
As the government can be
meyakinkan ya.
To visitor.
After the starting point, the second model, and the third model, we call it model based on level of trust. If the visitor trusts the condition after the pandemic. We can start the model from the C point. This is the proposed model to predict the number of visitors of Borobudur after the
COVID-19 pandemic period. Okay. This is the proposed model. The first model was best.
Okay. This is the proposed model. This three model. The first one is model based on previous crisis, and the second model is based on previous model with B as the starting point, and the third model is based on level of trust. Okay. So the conclusion,
to the effect of lockdown or
all that is crisis. I think there's any empirical data to state that, and special attention is needed to deal unexpected problem.
And then the third conclusion is
necessary is the level of tourist
confidence in the government management. And then we need to bear government management.
rise up the level of trusted tourism trusted. And we suggest them the sophisticated model can be used to predict tourism visitor growth.
So the four three model
we have to decide what's the best model to predict the number of visitor growth.
Okay. I think
that's my research paper presentation. Thank you, and please welcome if any question. If any question, I think it's a good, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Time
I give back to
moderator. Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Nindyo. Your paper is very incredible. I like your presentation data. Now come to the question and answer session. I like to have a three question from participant. Any question? Mr. Andrea, any question?
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. I'd like to ask Mr. Nindyo, using the three models that you have built, which one would you recommend to the government to put back the number of visitors to the starting level at least? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Any question again? Mr. Eri? Any question? No? No question. Okay. So please, I have one question from Mr. Andreas. Question for Mr. Nindyo. Please, Mr. Nindyo, you can answer it.
Thank you, Mr. Andreas, for your question. Based on your question, I think I suggest the third model, yeah, third model to
use government to push the number of visitors. But the third model have to apa?
Apa piring itu? Adjusted with apa? Which to build government crisis management, yeah, government crisis management, and makes
the visitor
trusted about the condition, can handle with government, yeah. I suggest the third model to predict number of visitor in Borobudur.
Thank you for your question, Pak.
Thank very you. Very clearly. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nindyo and Mr. Andreas. Any question again? Ms. Murthy, maybe you have a question for Mr. Nindyo? You don't have? Okay, thank you. Yes. I like your paper, Mr. Okay, thank you. I like your paper, Mr. Nindyo. Maybe I have one question for you. So I have a what are the government efforts to restore tourism that has fallen? If you have government trust, what the trust efforts from government?
Yeah, I think the government have to make visitor trust about the condition about the COVID-19 pandemic is handled in Borobudur area.
Okay.
If the visitor is trusted for that, I think the visitor will come to Borobudur, yeah, without apa, without any apa, no
worry
atau scary, yeah, what scary, yeah, because the tourism right now is the apa, termasuk apa namanya primary use, primary need for people. Yeah, if we trust is about the condition, I think tourism will come back in Borobudur and the Borobudur getting normal lagi. Thanks, Pak.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Nindyo. It's clear. So the last speaker today. So now I wait. Okay. Welcome to Mr. Eri Haryanto with the title Design and Build Remote Watering System Based on Internet of Things, IoT, Case Study of Yogyakarta Code Tourism Park. Please welcome Mr. Eri. Time is yours.
Okay, Mr. Madan, thank you for time to give to me. Okay, in this opportunity, in this session, I'd like to present our paper with title Design and Build Remote Watering System Based on Internet of Things, or IoT. Case study of Yogyakarta Codi Tourism Park. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, the first I would like to say thank you for coming in my presentation. It's great to see you all. This paper or this research is the result of our research. Their team, my team, any five. Anggota.
Team, your team.
Yes. There, our team. The first, I am Eri Haryanto. Second, Mrs. Fitri. And the third, Mrs. Rini. Fourth, Mr. Sofian. And fifth, Mr. Eri Marica Oki Nur Haryanto. Okay. The next. Firstly, I want to talk about research purpose. In this research, in this paper, we are have two research purpose. First, we are design and build an automatic plant watering system that can work in two modes, namely watering automatically based on schedule or watering time, and watering remotely via internet. Second, design and build an Internet of Things IoT based watering system by utilizing solar cell technology. And the research methodology, we are use systematic set of research methodology. They are waterfall. First, we are doing literature study. And second, analysis and design of our system. Third, we are coding system programming. Fourth, we are doing testing and evaluation that system running well. And the last fifth, the fifth is operation and maintenance the system. Next, there picture, we can understand that is architecture of our system that our purpose in our paper. This architecture is consists of several components. They are based our center of mini computer, namely Raspberry Pi board, Raspberry Pi 3 board. They are selain of
another.
Yes, another this mini board other mini computer mini. They are we use another module. They are any sensor module, then PAM module, their networking module, then solar panel module, and beside of the hardware, we are also build platform. That form is a web-based software application that installed in server. So hardware and software in this project is can work together. So we can get the system is namely Internet of Things. Okay, next. Their research location. Our research is a real location in Yogyakarta. That is in Chode Tourism Park in Cokrodiningratan Village, Jatis District, Yogyakarta City, Indonesia, with an area about 197.2 square meters. And there is a result of our research. There is set of platform. The platform is software web-based that installed in server. The watering system at the Chode Tourism Park is based on Internet of Things, which allows the system to be controlled remotely. And in this study, researchers built an IoT platform in the form of web-based software that can access by users who have authority. Yes, we must have a special account to enter the system. Next, there is a dashboard IoT platform. If we can success login to the platform or system, we will get this view. The dashboard page showing IoT device connected with IoT platform. The IoT platform software is prepared to be able to serve many IoT devices. So not just can use in Chode Tourism Park, but if any place ingin atau will use this platform is very very capable or very can use this platform. So we build this platform once can be used twice or third or berulang-ulang. Okay, in the next, this is page view of remote. After dashboard view, we are in remote page view. Nah, this view is showing user can remotely system from distance. So I stay in here in Alana Hotel and remotely and real time, I can remote our system in Chode. They are very far distance, maybe approximately 5 kilometers, but I can remote our system from here. And there is a view or interface can be used. And the next, they are a schedule page of system. Watering schedule setting are done online from the IoT platform, and the watering device at the Chode Tourism Park will always update the flash schedule when there is a change in the schedule on the IoT platform. The system is designed to still be able to flash on schedule when the internet connection drop. So although internet is drop or down, the system is still work. Still running, so not menjadi reason system itu down when internet is down. When internet is connection is connected, schedule synchronization will be carried out. So internet is use the very very main connection atau very main network is using system to synchronization from device in Chode Tourism Park and server in Kominfo or in Janabhadra data centers. So internet is the main network yang kami gunakan, views of our system. But if internet is down, system still work. Next, this page is we can look picture or figure. This device is also equipped with the soil moisture sensor that can read the soil moisture status in Tourism Park Chode. The sensor used in a use a soil moisture sensor to be able to unit the volume of water for watering in the water reservoir. A water level reader sensor is installed using an ultrasonic sensor. So in today, actually we use two sensor. The first is soil moisture sensor. Second is ultrasonic sensor. Two sensor acquiring data from sensor module and send data to controller, namely Raspberry Pi board, and then via internet connection, Raspberry sending data to server, and users can look and monitoring data with infographic or or tabular data using platform that we yang sudah kami bangun. Okay, next, ladies and gentlemen, they are a result of another experiment test of our hardware, our device in location. The first, we are test booster pump. Yes, to give flow water is so high, we must using booster pump. Because without this device or this pump, we cannot get the pressure of water so high. So we must use booster pump. And there in table, we can look that with direct order, with criteria activate the water pump direct, I turn on booster pump in electricity, the result water pump is on or can running well, and the normal result criteria it must be on. So result first in activate the water pump is okay, and then certain condition in the conditionnya in column criteria, the first, the water tower is still empty. When I turn on or with condition this, water pump condition is on. Then second, in condition the water tower is half filled, water pump still on. And when water pump when tower is fully filled with water, water pump is off. The condition or status booster pump is not active or not work, so water not be pumped from water source to tower. And then there is result of water pump. So in this research, everybody, any two pump, water pump. First booster pump and second is water pump. Water pump is second pump that menjadi pompa utama, main pump to mengambil air from water source to the tower. But and booster pump is increase pressure of the water to the end point. This is a sprinkle. In the test result of water pump in condition direct order with criteria activate the booster water pump directly, result of the water pump, I'm sorry, this is must be water pump, but I wrote here booster pump, seharusnya water pump. Resultnya ini on. Berikutnya when the condition electric faucet opened, booster pump on, and then with criteria electric faucet is closed, booster pump in here water pump is off. And then this is result of experiment, the motor reset ball valve to stop and give flow the water. We use module that's name namely motoris will develop there any condition and any criteria to test or experiment. We can look here from this table that's with input electricity with 220 volt electricity, we can operate or activate the motorized ball valve. With the duration 2 seconds, if we turn on this motorized ball valve in 2 seconds duration, their result voltage opening 20%, and then running in 4 seconds, opening 40%, in 6 seconds, opening 60%, in 8 seconds, opening 60%. And if we turn on the motorized ball valve in 10 seconds, we can get the water faucet is fully opened. They are open 100%. So water can be direct mengalir dari sumber from tower to sprinkle. And then with condition auto command, the faucet is given an open signal from the Raspberry Pi port. Their result, water faucet is fully opened. They are open in 100% condition. So water is fully can flow, can pass the faucet. The faucet is given a closed signal from the Raspberry Pi port. The water faucet is fully closed. So faucet is not open, walaupun 1% nggak ada. Di sini 0%, 0%. Because it's fully closed. And then result of the test internet connection, they are into the tourism bug. We use internet connection from Kominfo. They are open internet is installed in the tourism park. We can get internet connection with download bandwidth. There is 30.5 megabyte and the upload bandwidth x.4 megabyte. Next, ladies and gentlemen, I am agak confused because they are first. I speak in English. Thank you, Mr. Ramadan. Okay, I want to continue our presentation. This page, we are can look from the table. That is a result of the watering program with a schedule. With condition active schedule, with criteria flush schedule at 7 o'clock, duration 160 seconds. The result is schedule can be watering the plant in the location with duration 160 seconds. Pas schedule at 50 o'clock, duration in 160 seconds. The result is watering. Water can be semprotkan in tanaman, in plant. And with condition disabled schedule, with criteria flash schedule at 7 o'clock or 50 o'clock, they are no watering. So if condition schedule is disabled, system will not spray water to the plant. Although system being on, but system will read the setting from IoT platform. Then they are the result of the watering program with the remote distance. So we can remotely operate this system, watering system in Code from IoT platform from very far distant maybe with condition remote with criteria flash command during 10 second result can watering a plant then flash command during 30 second can watering can flash command during 60 second still watering and in criteria flash command during 160 second still watering so remote distant experiment give our result is memuaskan satisfy okay then in this picture or table we can look result of the view when device computer access this system this web first login page we can see the perfect view in notebook screen this is 15.6 inch and perfect view also in smartphone screen there is 5.5 inch and then in page dashboard page they are same with perfect view in notebook screen also in smartphone screen then in remote page in notebook screen perfect view in smartphone screen the result is perfect view 4 in schedule page in notebook screen so perfect view in smartphone screen also perfect view the last in monitoring sensor page in notebook screen it's give me perfect view and in smartphone screen it's still perfect view so the platform IoT that is web-based application give perfect view in any device we experiment into size of screen in notebook and in smartphone screen ladies and gentlemen we are as researchers very so happy why because this research or this project ternyata telah diliput covered by media in many media first we can look in a picture we are covered in KR Jogja in KR Jogja make a news that title menyirami tanaman bisa dilakukan dari jarak jauh second in media Jogjapolitan we are covered with title Taman Robin di Jogja inovasi penyiraman jarak jauh dengan sistem robot. Why this is Robin Park. In Jetis or in Cokrodinoratan Village, head of village give the name of our project with name Robin. Stand for robot otomatis nyuburki. Yes, disingkat menjadi Robin. The next in rri.co.id with title Taman Robin RTH ruang terbuka hijau Jetis Harjo maksimalkan energi untuk penyiraman tanaman. Nah, we can see the photo in this slide. There is a Code Tourism Park. In there we are memasang plang with Jana Badra logo Universitas Jana Badra with size maybe not too small but if from jarak jauh we can look Jana Badra so this is our researchers not just make research just theory but this is really we are implement and we are operating this device in location object or in Cokro Diningratan Village. Actually in Codi Tourism Park. And then we are also covered in Times Indonesia with title Ciptakan Robin, Wakil Wali Kota, Deputi Mayor of Kota Yogyakarta, beri apresiasi kepada dosen UJB. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, there are four news in online media yang kami dapatkan. Namun di luar ini masih ada beberapa liputan media yang kami belum masukkan ke sini. And they are make me really so happy because I am here can bisa masuk koran ya. Ya. Ada foto saya sama Ibu ya. Ya. Jadi dari sekian banyak personel alhamdulillah in this project I am being the leader or head of the team. And the final maybe we can look in conclusion. This research was conducted using the waterfall method with systematic stages to produce research result on the design of an IoT-based automatic plant sprinkler system with the help of a solar-based electrical power supply. Second, solar panel have succeeded in producing AC electricity with a voltage of 2020 volt assisted by an inverter so that it can be used to supply electricity to IoT device controller. An IoT based watering system has been successfully built and implemented at the Codi Tourism Park and now being operated in there. The watering mode consists of an automatic mode with a schedule that can be set from web-based IoT platform and a remote watering mode via the internet. Both watering modes work well and successfully watered the plant at the study site. Okay, maybe I think enough for present of our paper. And the next times I give to Mr. Ramadan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Your research is very marvelous. I like it. So come to question and answer session. I like to have a quick question from the participant for Mr. Eri, please.
Yeah, Mas Rama.
Okay, Miss Wika.
Yeah. I only just give some comments for Mr. Eri. Your research idea is great and really interesting, Mas Eri. And I hope you continue your research deeply with the environmentally friendly perspectives, such as environmentally benefit and collaborate with another team from another faculty or another science, such as environment science. I think this research is a good idea, really, really good idea, and will be more appreciate if you can wrap it with the another perspective, another field, Mas Eri. I think that's my suggestion for your research, but this is a really great idea.
Yes, Mrs. Thank you very much. Thank you for the essence and your masukan.
Thank you. Maybe Mr. Eric have menanggapi.
Yes, Mr. Rama. First, thank you very much to Mrs. Wika for the attention and masukan, Mbak. Feedback. Mbak ayo. Suggestion, ya. For the suggestion to us, ya. Yeah. Because this paper or this research not just me, but this is team. We are five anggota in teams. Insya Allah the next we will develop this research deeply with maybe in another perspective, so we can get the result of research or paper better than today. Okay, Mr. Nama, I think enough.
Yes. Your system was available on Play Store. If available on Play Store, I will
download. Not yet. Because from Kominfo to Jakarta, this is still in private system. Kalau nanti lancar akan masuk di jaringan environment GSS to Jakarta Smart City. Because from the Bapeda said that in GSS not yet can be look real smart city. Just pelayanan services, but belum ada yang bisa dilihat secara langsung. Nah, dengan ada ini harapannya ini Smart City Jogja kelihatan di sini, karena dari pilot project di CODI ini the next we will ditawari oleh Bapeda untuk mengembangkan di area sekitar Tugu. Tugu, we know that sedang dibangun pedestrian dengan tata letak yang cukup bagus, yes. And there sudah disiapkan, ladies and gentlemen, Bapak Ibu, di situ sudah disiapkan infrastruktur untuk membangun penyiraman otomatis. Jadi tinggal nunggu dari kami kapan siap untuk create di sana, ya kan? Mengingat nanti juga kami masih hitung-hitung dulu, karena di tempat yang real yang cakupannya cukup luas butuh dana yang lumayan itu. Yes, maybe enough, Mr. Ramadan. Pada intinya ini akan masih dikembangkan terus, Bapak Ibu, di sisi pengembangan implementasinya. Di sisi nanti mungkin tadi terkait dengan perspektif lain dari bidang lain, nanti juga perlu kami nanti juga tingkatkan. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Eri. Maybe any question again? Last question, maybe? Mr. Mindyo?
I think that's a good reason. I have no question for that. Just push Mas Ari to implement and more large in area, ya. Just okay. It's good reason.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mindyo.
For your commentar. Okay, maybe I have one question for you, Mr. Yeah. Are you ready? Just one question.
Enough.
Okay, maybe it's enough. Okay, maybe it's enough. Yeah, I think.
Moderator cannot answer.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your presentation. Very, very marvelous your information. Finally come to the end of this conference. Before I close the conference, please take a picture together. Please, all the participants, open the camera. Maybe I will capture your face. Wait a minute. Okay, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, thank you very much for all the participants. So maybe take the picture with the photograph. Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you.